Welcome to all hemp engineering friends around the world. This is another series of interviews that we will be posting in the next month. Today, we have the great pleasure having with us Mr. Jeffrey Tang. Mr. Jeffrey Tang is a pioneer in the hemp industry. He's got a very vast experience in farming and marketing products from Australia to the world, but particularly to the Chinese market. Jeffrey, this is a great honor for us to have you on board.
Thanks for having me.
Yes. Now we go straight to the questions.
Yeah.
So tell me, how did you end up industry?
All right, first of all, I've actually started out since 2013. That time, obviously, you know, globally, that time, every country is different in different steps of legalizing cannabis, right? Especially in 2013, the Charlotte's Web basically made a CBD boom that time. I actually stepped into the industry when I was trying to do the hydroponic supply. You know, as you know, everyone knows, you know, we are supplying, I mean, Chinese supplying the equipment, the hydroponic supply, the greenhouse supply, the lighting to global market. So I actually started out by supplying senior university plant breeding institution grow lights for their horticulture, tissue culture, research and you know, for wheat grow or for basically for the scientific or for the research purpose in their greenhouse in Sydney. So we've supplied all these LED grow lights with different spectrum. With, you know, that time LED grow lights is quite advanced, but it's not that mature. So we started doing the LED grow lights for the hydroponic or for the indoor farming purpose. And then obviously we started doing the organic nutrients and also the heating solution, smart control for the greenhouse, for the for all this basically indoor farming equipment.
Yes. So
that time, you have to have a controlled environment to grow cannabis in Australia in particular. And you're not allowed to expose to the sun, and it's hard to control. And also you don't want other people to see actually you growing something not 100% legal.
Agree.
Right? So this is how I actually get into the business. And since then, I've learned a lot of cannabis in general. As you know, everyone knows, you know, in the Asian or typically Chinese culture, it's been demonized for many, many years. So even my parents, my friends, my relatives, my business partners, they all criticize me. Why are you doing that? So I actually have very, very strong mind. I know I'm not breaking the law. I know this is going to be the future product or be the future industry. So I keep learning and deepening, you know, the information, the knowledge. Lucky we can actually research lots of things or Google lots of things through the internet. So I gained lots of experience since 2013. But anyway, this is how I step into the industry. Yeah.
One thing that I find most hempers that I interview in the last years, we all have same strong character that keep us on board regardless of the circumstances that are around the stigma.
Yeah.
Yes, and I must congratulate you because I know your work and I know your strength to avoid being depressed, that which is a common sickness or condition for people that are in long run careers.
Yeah.
Well, by assume that you have had a lot of headaches on regards of the prohibition itself. I just heard that you have had a lot of negative setback from families and friends, but yet you're on board. I guess I must ask you, beyond that experience, have you felt any prohibition effects on the business itself?
Well, certainly, as I mentioned earlier, so it's been demonized for a long, long time. I feel lucky, actually, I'm in Australia. But I mean, since I started, I feel sometimes very disheartened as well. The stigma, it's always very hard to tell people or to educate people when they have no idea what's happening. And when they heard about our cannabis or in particular marijuana, the word, or in Mandarin or in Chinese, it's only one word. The whole dharma, which is the typical words, it's been demonized long time, and people think that's a prohibited drugs anyway. So once you get in touch with that, you're going to be put in the jail straight away. Very very basic or very emblematic example is Jackie Chan. Everyone know Jackie Chan, right?
Yes.
Jackie Chan's son actually smoked marijuana in Beijing and got reported and he got put into the jail straight away. All right, no questions asked. So everyone knows, in different countries, you smoke a little bit, joints, it's fine. You're not going to be like criminalized like that. But in China, as long as you have a touch, even just a sip or something related to this thing, you're gonna be in big trouble. But
Jeffrey, Australia is not that far away from that feeling of criminalization of people. In Western Australia in particular, you get caught with a joint or you're driving and you have remainings of the THC in your system, you are considered a criminal, that you don't go to jail as Malaysia or other countries, but your life can basically be affected negatively.
Exactly, but I feel in the English background or English speaking country, because we have the terminology or whatever, the different wording, say hemp, marijuana, cannabis, all these different, word, then you can actually differentiate this thing already better than the Chinese speaker.
Mm-hmm.
So I think by mentioning hemp, you're already referring the low THC or non-THC cannabis crop,
yes,
which already a big step forward, I would say, to differentiate the marijuana, which, the recreational side from the industrial or the general using side of the cannabis. So this is, I think, because I'm a non-smoker, I'm not a marijuana or THC user myself. So I have very clear vision and I know the pathway, how we're going to get over, further down the track, how we're going to develop the hemp industry without it getting any stigma of, this marijuana THC stuff. And also in China, 2018 and 2019 is very, very important because Chinese government has been legalized the industrial hemp, which the THC under 0.3%. Which, the same definition as lots of different countries. But I know WA is 1%, New South Wales is 1% in Australia, am I correct?
Yes.
So the rest of the country, except Canberra, of course, that's recreational legal side. But I mean, in terms of the terminology or the definition of the industrial cannabis, that hemp is 0.3% under. So this is the concept. So I personally think education is still the key, because if you cannot tell what's the difference between hemp and marijuana, basically you have to have a good mindset towards cannabis as a whole, and then you know what is hemp, what's a real the real difference, and then the next step is to educate them how good or how beneficial the hemp crop going to be, and what about other cannabinoid which extracted from the same plant, and how they're going to affect your body,
everything,
your mind,
yes.
Everything, and also for the environmental side, which we're working on. I'm sure we're going to talk about the next question.
Yeah, but that brings us to conclude these questions, because at the end of the day, it is the way I see it. It is science versus politics, because even though hemp may have a 0.3%, with proper technology, you still can extract THC and you do with it what you want. So it is a little bit awkward. If you are going to grow, let's say, for housing or building construction, it doesn't matter if you have 20% of THC, if that is going to be used for construction. So it is still early ages, early stage in worldwide on regards of what we need to achieve in the industry itself. It's a lot of things to go.
Agreed.
Jeffrey, tell us about your projects, your dreams. I do understand that you are about to start building a home, a hempcrete home in Sydney. Among other
things. Yeah, I applied with council already for the extension or for to further develop my existing property. My property in Sydney, it's a house. It's a traditional double brick sandstone house. Actually, under the process. I applied DA. I'm waiting for DA to be granted, and then we're going to using the hemp crete technology or hemp building technology to build the extension, which we can have more room, of course, for the family for living purpose, and also at the same time, I can compare, you know, how the hemp building, the greener building, how we compare this to a traditional brick, double brick building. So I'm very excited about the project. Also, you know, we want to make this as an emblematic project or showcasing demonstration house to show the public this is very, very achievable. And this is very, very good for the environment, for the building industry, for the construction industry, for the household, for everyone. So very excited actually working on that at the moment. So we're going to have the regular update afterwards. And also thanks for Ramon being a very, very good partner. We're working on this actually together, right?
Honor for Hemp Engineering also to be part of this project. Yeah. Jeffrey, tell us, do you truly believe that the hemp can become a sustainable answer or a part of a circular economy possibility to achieve better results for the earth itself?
Certainly, I'm actually a strong believer of that because I think people in this industry, we all know hemp can be used for, you know, they have more than 50,000 different uses, right, for everything. So definitely, this is a kind of core. I would say it has a holistic thing. Can some people even claim they can save the mankind or save the environment, whatever? So by creating the hemp recycle material and hemp battery storage, and also the greener building, everything the hemp plastic, I think in this kind of direction, we are really solving the problem, like CO2 emission, the carbon taxing, you know, which now is getting worse and worse globally, the global warming thing. And, you know, the bushfire we had now 2 years ago for Australia, it's all because of that. And also the climate changes dramatically and the tsunamis, earthquakes, everything, you know, the weather is so unpredictable now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I think by using hemp, we can have lots of benefit for the economy, for the sustainable development, which we are very, very focusing on that. And I think all the governments, you know, they have to focusing on that just because, you know, there's a bit of lag over here, over there. But eventually, I think our industry is going to be supported by majority of the governments globally, because we're not costing, we're not actually developing our economy or our life or society or living standards by at the cost of our future generation. That's very important.
Jeffrey, it's been a great pleasure talking to you, listening to your dreams, what we are after, and particularly the hope that we can build a better world.
Thank you.
Would you like to add something else to the audience?
I mean, we are working on a lot of projects actually at the same time. I mean, for personal use, for construction purpose, for greener energy, for greener building, for plastic purpose,
our battery,
yeah, hemp battery, lots of things. And we are actually about to push more medicinal type of products to the market. We start from UK, America, Australia, and soon I am focusing on how we're gonna push this into the biggest market, which is the Asia market. So I really want to partner with hemp pioneers like Ramon, like everyone globally, to make this happen quicker and in a much solid form. So yeah, this is what I'm passionate about, what I'm working on. So welcome everyone to join us, and we can share the same vision, and we can work together, make the effort together. So hopefully we can achieve something, really, really going to be beneficial to our mankind in the future generations.
Thank you very much, Jeffrey.
Thank you for your time,
it's a pleasure. Always a pleasure talking to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramon. All right. Ciao. Cheers. Bye.